Live, local, breaking news. This is WYFF News 4 at 6 in high definition.
The calendar says October 18th, but it looks a whole lot like Election Day in North Carolina. Let the voting for president begin in North Carolina, that is.
This morning, the polls opened and the lines grew early on this, the very first day of early voting there in North Carolina. News 4's Nigel Robertson with our report tonight from Hendersonville.
The lines have formed all over North Carolina.
I've told everyone. I've put it on Facebook, Twitter, everywhere. Vote. Get out and vote.
Early voting is officially underway in the Tar Heel State. Here at the Henderson County Elections Office, people say the fact that North Carolina is considered a swing state makes the whole voting process that much more vital.
Why I'm here is because I think this is probably the most important election we've had in decades. I really do.
Are you surprised by the line?
Yes.
As the day goes on, this line just keeps getting longer and longer. One woman says that her husband, it only took 30 minutes to vote. Now people are waiting in line about an hour just to cast their ballot.
But it's worth the wait. If I have to stand in a line 3 miles long, I will.
Exactly.
In order to vote.
Here is what the lines looked like in Charlotte. Election officials say by the time Election Day comes around, more than 65% of North Carolina voters will have already cast their ballot. Nigel Robertson, WYFF News 4, Hendersonville, North Carolina.
And this reminder, South Carolina does not have early voting. You can vote absentee right now, but only if you give a reason why you may not be able to vote on November 6th.
And back now to South Carolina, where Governor Nikki Haley has created a commission to update the state's ethics laws. The governor named the panel today, pointing out there are no elected officials on the panel. She says an independent body is the best way to get true ethics reform. The organization will be co-chaired by two former attorneys general. There's one, Republican Henry McMaster, and Democrat Travis Medlock.
We have to acknowledge the fact that, you know, we have weak ethics laws. They're very gray. They don't specify exactly where we should be. South Carolina has been at the bottom when it comes to ethics reform. Let's take it to the top.
The commission has 11 members in all, including some from the South Carolina bar, law enforcement, and the media.
DUI charges have now been filed in an accident that killed a Clemson student early Tuesday morning. 20-year-old Patrick McCool has been charged with felony DUI involving death. He appeared for a bond hearing this afternoon and was granted a $50,000 bond. Investigators believe he was under the influence when he lost control of his car on Shiloh Road and hit a tree. The accident killed Tyler Earl Sands. It was his 22nd birthday. McCool will be allowed to return home to Virginia, where he will be on home detention and must receive alcohol counseling. A Spartanburg woman is also facing a DUI charge for an accident that killed her passenger. Highway Patrol troopers say 64-year-old Patricia Norton was driving on Woodburn Road last night. Her car went off the side of the road and hit a tree. 59-year-old Dave Blaine Sanders, also of Spartanburg, was in the car with her and was killed. Highway Patrol is still investigating the wreck.
Greenville County investigators tell us they've uncovered a meth lab operating inside a home with seven children living in the same home. Warrants say investigators searched the home at 625 Garrison Road in Pelzer yesterday. They tell us they found meth-making materials and a disposal site there on the property. Abigail Arellano, Alicia Dees, Greg Lee Johnson, and Michael Thomason are all charged with manufacturing meth, disposal of meth waste, and making meth in the presence of a child. The Department of Social Services was called in, and tonight all seven children have been turned over to the custody of a family member.
Spartanburg County investigators have found a man wanted for attempted murder. Joseph Michael Garza was arrested yesterday when a tip led investigators to an outbuilding on Garner Road. Investigators say they found Garza hiding there. He faces attempted murder and drug charges stemming from a shooting on September 25th. Investigators say he shot this woman, Ashley Directo, in the chest. They say she is Garza's girlfriend. She recovered from the shooting and was with him in the outbuilding yesterday. Investigators believe the couple and a third man, Jeffrey Smalley, who you see there, were manufacturing meth in the building. They are all being held at the Spartanburg County Detention Center.
A change of plea hearing is now scheduled for a man accused of recruiting investors into a multi-million-dollar Ponzi scheme. Lindsey Howell had a bond hearing in Greenville yesterday where he was granted a $1 million bond. He is accused of conspiring with former Anderson County Councilman Ron Wilson to defraud hundreds of investors of Atlantic Bullion and Coin. At the bond hearing yesterday, Howell told the judge that after first refusing to cooperate, he now would like to change his plea to guilty, and so he will be able to do that, we're told, on November 16th.
Project Economy News for you now, and more jobs are on the way to Greenville County. Siemens Industry Incorporated announced that it will build a new plant in Malden. It will manufacture gears, motors, and drives. It will employ about 30 people, and this is a $2 million investment in a 45,000 square foot facility.
South Carolina's only co-op grocery store is coming soon to Spartanburg. The Hub City Co-op Market will make use of a building that's been empty for more than 15 years now. This is near the USC Upstate College of Business and the Chapman Cultural Center. The community-owned grocery store will be open to the public, and it'll offer natural and local food as well. The Hub City Market's been 2 years in the making, we're told, and it has the support of the Food Co-op Initiative.
This is an absolutely critical piece. When you think about basic of food, shelter, and clothing, to build a solid community, a solid foundation for people to thrive, we have clothing, we have shelter, we don't have the food. This is the last leg of that three-legged stool to build the solid foundation downtown.
Okay, you saw the before, there's the after. Once enough money is raised, the renovation will start, and construction is expected to take 10 to 12 months. These are renderings, of course, of what it'll all look like. And the co-op did choose a local architectural firm, McMillan Pasden Smith.
Well, as we get deeper into fall and heaters are beginning to be turned on, an upstate fire chief is sending out a warning that could save your life. News 4's Mandy Gaither is live and local in our Anderson newsroom tonight. And Mandy, this warning comes with two words, smoke detectors.
That's right, Gabby. The causes of fires recently in Oconee County are all different, but firefighters say there's one thing that's the same in all of them, the lack of a working smoke detector.
It's hard to imagine anyone being able to survive the fire that took this home on Tammy Lane in Walhalla, but somehow Timothy Sammons made it out alive, although he's still in critical condition after being burned over half his body. His brother says they had a smoke detector, but it wasn't working, something Oconee County firefighters are seeing all the time.
It protects you from the daily smoke. It alerts you when you have a fire in the home to where you can escape.
Assistant Fire Chief Shane Gibbs says he's seen a significant increase in house fires lately, like this one on Nebo Church Road in Seneca last month. And he says if there was a smoke alarm in the recent fires, it needed a battery or just didn't work.
A smoke detector can definitely save your life. It can alert you from the deadly smoke in your house.
Gibbs says batteries should be changed at least twice a year. Sammons' brother wishes the one here had been working so that Timothy could have gotten out sooner.
And for Oconee County residents who can't afford a smoke detector, you can call the Oconee County Emergency Services, that number 638-4220, and they'll get you a free one. There are similar services in other upstate county fire departments as well. Mandy Gaither, WYFF News 4, live in the Anderson newsroom.
Hey, summer's over, but the bears aren't hibernating yet. After at least six bear encounters in the western North Carolina mountains, the Forest Service is closing two huge areas to campers. News 4's Mike McCormick is live and local on the story in our Spartanburg newsroom tonight. Mike, any idea how long they'll be closed?
Well, Michael, the Forest Service hasn't set a timeline yet, but rangers do intend to keep monitoring that area and then make a decision on when to allow camping again.
I saw a lot of bear signs, you know, scratch marks on the trees.
But it's what Brian Flack didn't see.
Never saw a bear.
That makes him pretty lucky, especially when you consider the fact that he's been camping here in the Pisgah National Forest.
It'd be four nights now.
He came out of the woods today and found out that the Forest Service is no longer allowing camping in the Shining Rock Wilderness, which is more than 18,000 acres, and graveyard fields. There are no campgrounds here, so only backcountry camping is impacted.
It's the mountains. There's bears. I don't understand the closure. I mean, I guess safety reasons.
Safety is at risk, according to the Forest Service, which tells us that a bear damaged a tent and a food bag Monday night. Two people were in the tent at the time. They were not hurt.
It's just weird that they would close the entire thing like that, especially because, you know, there's as popular as it is, it's probably one of the most popular areas around to hike, and right during peak fall season, it's a shame. So I'm glad I got my hike in.
Hiking is okay. It's overnight camping that isn't.
You're always concerned. It's part of it. You know, it's kind of what makes it exciting somewhat is it's the wilderness, and you got to be careful.
And rangers say you could be fined if you're caught camping in those areas. Mike McCormick, WYFF News 4, live tonight in the Spartanburg newsroom.
All right, Mike, thank you. It is only Thursday, but it's never too early to talk about college football.
Absolutely, right? And homecoming celebrations begin tonight at Furman. Fans can attend an 8:15 pep rally and bonfire to kick things off. It is at the Milford Mall in front of the James Duke Library. And then tomorrow night at 7 o'clock, students will show off their homecoming displays on the mall. Furman plays Georgia Southern on Saturday at 1:30. And it is Military Appreciation Day in Death Valley this weekend, and Clemson's game ball begins its journey tonight here in Greenville. The ball run begins at 10:30 at the Rudolph Anderson Jr. Memorial in Cleveland Park. Clemson is honoring Anderson's memory as the 50th anniversary of his death approaches. The Clemson graduate and Air Force pilot was shot down on October 27, 1962. He was the only person killed in the Cuban Missile Crisis. ROTC students from Clemson and Virginia Tech will take part in the run.
Now your live Super Doppler 4HD weather forecast.
And live Super Doppler 4HD showing that little sliver of some rain right along the Tennessee-North Carolina border in particular, then some showers with even some brief heavy showers now beginning to move into downtown Spartanburg and also in through parts of Anderson, right along the Anderson and Abbeville County border here. And these showers are moving quickly off to the northeast. This is right along the cold front, which is pushing through the area. And behind the front, we have these showers backed up against the mountains themselves. First, we'll head on into the upstate and take a look and see what these showers are. Right as I mentioned, right along the Anderson-Abbeville border here, a couple little showers developing in the west central part of Lawrence County. And here's all the showers covered most of Spartanburg County and moving quickly off the northeast. So you folks in Gaffney and Blacksburg up by 85, you could be looking at some rain showers here shortly. Most of the mountains of North Carolina are pretty quiet, except, as I mentioned, right along that Tennessee border, all the way back into Graham and also in through Cherokee counties, we're looking at some light rain associated with that behind the front. 72 is our official high today at the JFK International Airport. 49 the low this morning, and that is very close to the average for this time of the year. The Asheville Regional Airport, 65 the high this afternoon, 47 the low so far on this date. Outside right now, cloudy skies. The rain has come to an end in downtown Greenville. Currently 64 degrees. Northwest wind at 6 miles per hour. Humidity high at 88%. Light rain and rain in and around the Spartanburg area. Currently 64 degrees. West to northwest winds at 8 miles per hour. Humidity right now at 88%. And mostly cloudy skies in Anderson, a few peaks of sun. Current temperature 69 degrees, a west to northwest wind at 7 miles per hour, humidity at 75%. And in Asheville right now it's 63, south to southwest winds at 10 miles per hour and relative humidity at 75%. So 55 in Boone, 59 degrees in Hendersonville, 63 as I mentioned in Nashville, also in Franklin, 61 in Andrews. Here comes that little bit cooler air behind the front. And then ahead of the front, it's still mild, 73 degrees for you folks in Greenwood, 70 in Abbeville, 71 in Elberton. Once the front goes by, the cooler temperatures will arrive. Upper 70s in Columbia and Florence right now and in Augusta. In fact, all three cities reported temperatures around 80 just an hour ago. So some very warm temperatures ahead of the front with more sunshine, as you can see, during the day today. Then the clouds came in, and if we'd seen more sun during the day today, these showers that are moving through would have been thunderstorms. So a slight chance we could hear a couple claps of thunder. But the front, most of its energy is to our north and to our south, as you can see, and right in between is where we are. And a few showers are beginning to develop. And the upper level lows spitting some showers and some cool showers at that. In fact, it's only 49 degrees right now in Minneapolis, while it's 91 in Brownsville, Texas. So isolated showers this evening, maybe a couple claps of thunder, especially in the eastern part of the upstate. Mostly cloudy skies with isolated showers, especially the closer you get to the Tennessee border this evening. Mostly sunny skies tomorrow. The breeze will pick up during the afternoon hours. Mild, high 73 in the upstate, but a cool 63 with a northwest wind in the mountains. And then not a bad day on Saturday. Mostly sunny skies across the area, maybe a few more clouds in the mountains. And overall, the weekend looking pretty nice. Beautiful autumn weather for the upcoming weekend.